Good afternoon, everyone. I believe we are live, or hopefully we are live. This is Richard Dubé. First of all, I hope everyone are as well as can be in these incredible and crazy times, but the social distancing is relaxing a little bit. Let's not get too excited, but there's certainly a brighter future. So we'll get there eventually, promise. Welcome again to this live video, this live demo, I should say, on our new product, new educational product at Siebel and the World Brewing Academy. First, my name is Richard Dubé. I'm the Director of Online Education. I've been in the industry for over 40 years, starting as a microbiologist with Molson, then Labatt's, Budweiser, moved to the United States with Sam Adams, or Boston Beer Company. And after 20 years, elected to take a break, if you will, and I got into education, did my Master in Arts of Education, and taught high school science for 10 years. During that time, though, I didn't leave the brewing industry entirely. I stayed in contact through Siebel as an instructor, both campus and online. And 2011 or so, came back to the industry with Siebel as the Director of Online Education, and also the proud co-founder and brewmaster of a local brewery here in Northern Kentucky. So once again, welcome to this hour. I hope I'll be able to fulfill your needs here. We will be looking at what we call specialized lectures. And let me explain to you what it is before we get into really showing you the platform and the various features and benefits of it. So Siebel, first of all, Siebel and the World Brewing Academy I've been providing online education for over 20 years. We have several programs of different depth of knowledge, from entry level that we call the executive, the intermediate level that we call the concise, and the advanced level that we call the advanced brewing theory program. So all those programs, all those courses have been offered, most of them, both online and campus. Take some time, obviously, to do those programs. So we needed something else that would be, I believe, more to the needs of our customers or our brewers. And what I'm talking about is those specialized lectures. By the way, if at any time you wish to ask me a question, I'll try to monitor my other screen and see what is going on. So I apologize if I break here and there, but we're going to try to manage that together. So going back to the specialized lecture, so it's not everybody that has, let's be real honest and realistic, it's not everybody that has the time nor the finance to get into a full-blown course, but there's no denying that everybody needs more education. And we need to learn something new every day so we can get better at what we're doing. And when we look at that, because of the lack of time and maybe the lack of finance, we need to have another avenue that can provide high quality, tested, created by content expert, and delivered on a slick platform, the information that you're seeking. So the specialized lectures, imagine like a book on beer production that goes from barley to brewing engineering, pumps and valves and glycols and everything in between. And that book contains close to 120 different chapters or very, very specific topics. Well, give you an example. You're in quality control. Not that you wouldn't like to know more about, let's say, malting, for instance, but really what would help you on a day-to-day basis and probably would help your employer is to know more about, let's say, detection and identification of beer contaminants. or somebody else is in brewing, again, not that he wouldn't like to know more about packaging, but really what would help them is to know about mashing or the brand new mash filter that they just purchased, and so on and so forth. So as you can see, you can really focus your acquired knowledge to something very, very specific that will fit your needs. So this is what the specialized lectures are. So let me show you a little bit what we are talking about. So I'm going to make myself disappear, first of all. There you go. And I'm going to bring you to the platform, itself. So this is the login page of the World Brewing Academy. For those who are not familiar, World Brewing Academy is a partnership that goes back over 20 years between Siebel Institute of Technology in Chicago and the Domans Academy in Munich. Some of our courses actually allow dual campus, if you will, dual campus formation or education by spending some time in Chicago and spending some time in Munich, which is of course kind of pretty cool. So let's go back to this. So this is your login page. Let me check. Somebody says hello from France. Hello, Marie. So we're going to log in. So I'm logging in as a student, since this is the view that you will that you would see. So it lands on the dashboard. So this is what the dashboard looks like. It's always on top, the last lecture that you have been working on. Let me just do a little sidebar here. What are those lectures? Well, the lectures, like I said, they are, right now we have over 70 different topics. And by the end of this year or early next year, we're probably going to have over 100, 110 different topics. So they are singular, quote unquote, self-contained, standalone, that you can focus on something totally specific. They are fully narrated, and they last anywhere from, I think the shortest one is about 25 minutes of narration, whereas the longest one is close to 2 hours. And we have everything in between. The one today that we will not see in its entirety because it's over 69 minutes, but it will give you a good feel of what those lectures are. So let's go back to the platform. So on the left-hand side here, you have your panel. So I can look at all the lectures that I'm currently enrolled in. So that's one way of looking at it. Or if I just look at the dashboard here and I scroll down, I'm going to see all the lectures that I am currently enrolled in. Then on the left panel, you have your profile. I don't always like to use this analogy, but I'll use it anyway. Once you have access to the platform, let's call it, it's like your Facebook account. So you create an account, you have access to it. It's your own. You can put a picture for your profile. You can enter your bio. You can decide to share your bio with other people. I'll show you later, but you even have a place where you can download and save some very specific files if you want to. So it's there. Let's say you are working on it now and for the next month or so, and then you don't come back until a few months. Well, all the information short of the lecture itself will be there. So we have my completed lectures. So my completed lectures give you an overview of everything that you have completed so far. So this is all the different lectures that I have completed so far with the badges that I earned, and I'm going to go back to the concept of badges, gives you the date when you completed it. And if you want to go back to the learning objectives, this is one way of getting at it. Then you have you have a calendar. You have your frequently asked questions. And like I said, you have my files. So my files, you can download up to 100 megabytes of files, and they will reside on your platform for you to enjoy later. There's a glossary. Glossary is something that you can download, that you can save. Not necessarily just on the platform, but you can save on your own PC. But it basically gives you a glossary that we keep on adding to it on brewing terms, and it is searchable by the first letter. So as you can see, okay, the dextrins, what are dextrins? So here you have the information. So it's something that is obviously very nice to have while you are going through the lecture and you are unsure of a specific term. Help button, if you have any technical issues, you're gonna click on this. And terms and conditions, actually the first time that you will land on the page, you will actually have to accept the terms and conditions. So let's go back to our dashboard. I just made myself appear here just so we have a face that goes with those lectures. So let me explain that a little bit in more detail. So we have, of course, the title. Like I said, this is the last lecture that I have worked on recently. It gives you the name of the content expert. The content expert is that person from the industry, either that I've been in the industry for a while, is retired, or is still in the industry. We have experts from anywhere and everywhere in terms of location, from the States, from Canada, from UK, etc. But they are people that are well known into their specific, let's say, sphere of topics. We're going to see later that there's a short bio also for this content expert. The content expert have created those lectures in a very guided way, and they have also created the narration. The narration, or the script, if you will, is created by the content expert. And it's important because I have to tell you that not all content experts were very, comfortable with the idea to narrate their own lectures. So we have some professional narrator that did the narration. But since we had the script created from a content expert, there was absolutely no issues of doing otherwise. So we have a progress wheel that tells me roughly how many, the percentage that I've completed so far. And let's go see something that says view details here. So each lectures, when you open the view details, will bring you to its unique page like this. So again, title, the content expert, my progress wheel here, and here, review pack. I'm going to talk about pack in a second, but you have the lecture button and the download PDF. Basically, the download PDF is that you can download in PDF format the entire screenshots of the lecture that you are going through. On this page, you have a clear lecture description of what the lecture is all about. And since we are talking about an educational tool, you have the learning objective. So the learning objective is really what we want you, or what we expect you to get at the end of this lecture. So in this case of introduction to hops, we're talking about discuss the historical role hops play in brewing, describe the benefits of brewing with hops, and et cetera, et cetera. On the page also, you have this button, contact monitor. So since you are in what we call an asynchronous environment, meaning that you are, quote unquote, by yourself, you go through the lecture at your own pace, but you have questions. Well, this is where you're going to go. So contact monitor is not necessarily the content expert that created that particular lecture, but it is a content expert, somebody that will be able to answer your questions. So it opens your email. It already populates the subject line with the title of the lecture, so our content expert knows which lecture we are referring to. And then you just type in I'm not very good at typing, but anyhow, you type and you simply send, and one of our content experts will reply back to you as soon as possible. On that same page, finally, we have a little picture of Nick here, and we have his bio down there. So let me go back up here and talk about this PAK, P-A-K. So what is that P-A-K? P-A-K stands for Pre-Acquired Knowledge Quiz. And why do we have that? Well, a little bit of a educational trick, if you will. It's a self-evaluation, if you will, of what you know, what you don't know, and what you're going to learn. So I'm going to show you something here. I think I picked it up. Going to make myself disappear just so you can see the entire screen. So as you can see here, okay, of all the lectures that I'm enrolled in, some shows view details, take back quiz, and some don't have that take back quiz. It's because I have already taken it. And maybe you have noticed, but just going to go back to one that I haven't done yet. When you look at the front page, it said take back quiz, and the lecture button and the download button are not activated yet. We are forcing you to take the PAK quiz to unlock the lecture and unlock the download. Again, it's just an idea of helping you kind of conceptualize what you understand, what you already know about the topic, what you don't know, what you absolutely have no clue, and so on and so forth. Let's go back to the lecture that I will demo in a minute here. Right here, oh, sorry, right there. All right, of course, I'll get it eventually. There you go. Okay. So the one that is of interest for us today, this is the one that that we selected through a survey, actually, of people wanting to see one of those lectures, and we stopped on yeast management and lean practices. So as you can see, I have 16% completed, and this one doesn't show take back quiz because I have simply done it already. So I go to my view details, and there it goes again, progress wheel, title, content expert, the name, review pack quiz. We're gonna see now the lecture is unlocked and the download PDF is unlocked as well. So let's look at the lecture description. Again, a clear description of what you should expect during the lecture, and the learning objectives, again, there to help you, kind of guide you during the lecture to say, okay, those are the things that I'm expected to retain at the end of this lecture. Identify resources for selecting and propagating the select yeast strain for a brewery. Provide sound standard operating procedure to ensure adequate yeast pitch rates, etc., etc. Again, your contact monitor. And in this case, happened that it's Nick that also created this this lecture with his bio down here. So let's find that. Oh, no, sorry. Let's go take a look at review pack quiz. So I have done it already. Didn't fare too well, 1 out of 10, but you know, no big deal. So I can review. You will notice that throughout the pack quiz and also the actual knowledge check that we have throughout the lecture, you'll see that there's a tremendous amount of value to the information that is given in the feedback itself. What I mean by that is that, okay, so we have a question here, true or false. Okay, it's nice to know that you have it correct or incorrect, but what is the rationale behind the question? What are the other information that helps you to kind of wrap up a little bit better the entire information that is provided? So yes, this one is true, and this is my feedback. Look at the others. All the others have a tremendous amount of information, and they are just true false. And you must admit with me that it's only 50% chance. It is obviously not graded. It's not the point. The point is just to give you a feel of what you know, what you don't know. But each question will definitely give you a tremendous amount of information that relates to the particular questions. And this is where the educational value resides. So I reviewed it. So, okay, I'm happy with that. I'm going to close and I'm going to go see my lecture. Any questions so far? It doesn't look like it. Hello to everyone. Nice to have you with me this afternoon. So let's go take a look to the lecture. And I might just shut up for a few minutes and let you listen to the lecture. The lecture will open in a separate window. There you go. There goes my separate window. Eventually. Of course, because we are live, we have some glitches. Okay, so it's always going to be like this. So as you have seen, I had already 16% complete, but frankly, I've started out a while ago. I don't fully remember. So no, I don't want to resume where I left off. So I'm just simply going to say no, and it's going to restart from the beginning. Me again, just to show you a couple of little things before we finally get to the lecture. But you have every lecture has the navigation instruction, which is as simple as just telling you what each buttons are there for. So we have a menu. Sometimes we might have a glossary inside the lecture itself that pertains to very specific topics, not topics, but words in that a particular lecture. We are populating that as we go, but the entire glossary I showed you earlier. You have, of course, an audio buttons. You have a pause, play pause, and you have a seek bar or scroll bar. You can at any point in time pause, restart, rewind, go forward a little bit, and so on and so forth. So you can take your own notes and really zoom in on something that you might have missed in the information. I can tell you at this point that those lectures have been designed with educational experience in mind, and it is well proven. Yes, it's a little bit more work, but it is well proven that the level, the percentage of retention of the information is much higher when the learner is forced to actually take his or her own notes and kind of rehash the information they just heard in their own words. That's the best way to retain the information. So there's a tremendous amount of information that is in the narration, and this is where the focus needs to be. You can replay the entire slide, and you have a previous button and the next button, and of course an exit button. Very quickly, just to tell you why do we have previous and next button, why it sounds pretty obvious, if you will, if you want to go back. However, we have a menu that allows you to go back to very specific slides whenever you want. We want to keep the experience as interactive as possible. If you're like me, if I spend too much time in front of a computer, and if the lecture would be set up as a continuous video, if you will, it would take only a few minutes and I would fall asleep. So to be interactive, we're forcing the learner to actually make some actions. And yeah, the action could be as simple as clicking the next button to go to the next slide. But still, it keeps you a little bit more involved than just trying to watch something or listen to something. So we have the next button. So here I'm going to finally make myself disappear for a while. And let's go and listen part of that lecture, and I will give you more information as we go along. So there he goes.
Well, welcome to another lecture in Module 3, Yeast and Fermentation. This lecture is titled Yeast Management and focuses on the importance of taking care of our cultures of brewing yeast. Start with a quote from Charles E. Lieberman from Short Services in New York. Life without brewer's yeast would hardly be worth living. No beer. And we'll have one more quote This one is from Chris Bolton of Bass Brewers. The livelihoods of all those employed within the industry are dependent directly or indirectly on the ability of yeast to transform wort into beer. Hence, yeast is the brewer's most precious asset, and its welfare should be accorded the highest priority. As both quotes simply state, as brewers, we must diligently take care of our yeast cultures. Our entire business depends on their health and vitality. Without a doubt, the most important ingredient to bring you success is your yeast. It needs to be handled properly, and it falls under the policy, rules, and procedures that you would implement. Those methods will establish the guidelines for the selection, the propagation, the pitching, the cropping, and the storage of your most loyal and hard-working ally, aka your yeast slurry. In the next few slides, we'll briefly address some of the key points.
I'm going to stop here for a second simply because I just figured out how to look at my comments or questions. And there's a question, a very good question here from Catherine Gooding. She's asking, will this platform replace the LMS that is being used for the concise course? Catherine, eventually it will. We've been working for the past few years to entirely revamp all our lectures on all our programs that are online, the executive, the concise, and the ABT. And it will reside on this platform. The concise is designed a little bit differently simply because it's an intermediate level of depth of knowledge. And so therefore it's designed in a way that actually there's a little bit more information on the slide and a little bit less on the narration, but still it will be differently on this platform. Thank you, Catherine, for the question.
At the end of this lecture, you should be able to state the following. I can identify resources for selecting and propagating the select yeast strains for a brewery, provide sound standard operating procedures to ensure adequate yeast pitch rates, discuss the various methods of cropping yeast cultures and maintain high quality cultures for repitching, identify important parameters for quality storage of yeast cultures, and finally, I can discuss the considerations of a brewery's production and incorporation of yeast management.
So like I said, you have your learning objectives. Basically, again, you know, we cannot take away that this is an educational tool. We want you to learn more and to learn well about very specific topics. And those objectives will help you, will guide you, will keep you, let's say, structured into what are the different specific goals that you need to retain at the end of your lecture.
The outline of our lecture of yeast management will move through the process of bringing in a new yeast culture into the brewery, using it for production, and then cropping and storing the culture for future use. Starting with the definition of yeast management. For uses in this lecture, yeast management is the careful control across all operations handling yeast cultures to maintain the highest possible quality and overall health so as to provide timely and repeatable fermentations within standards of specifications both quantitatively and organoleptically. This means that every aspect of yeast and fermentation needs to be carefully and thoughtfully monitored to best protect our yeast culture. Yeast management will look at the selection of the yeast strain chosen for its attributes and ability to work within the brewery's design. We'll also discuss briefly the propagation options available to the modern craft brewery. We will discuss in detail the pitching and aeration methods for inoculating the yeast culture into fresh wort, and also the aspects of monitoring the fermentation process. We will then move on to the various harvesting or cropping methods and how to ensure a healthy culture is removed from the finished fermentation and preserved for future use. We will finally conclude with a focus on production considerations, whereby the inclusion of yeast management is incorporated into the overall production of the brewery. Just how important of an aspect the management of our yeast cultures is within the brewery. So we'll start with the selection of a particular yeast strain. When selecting a particular yeast strain, one of the first criteria to explore is the desired beer style, an ale, a lager, a sour, a wheat, etc. Are you looking for a neutral profile from your yeast, or do you expect to get an additional layer of flavors from the fermentation? Those are some of the questions that will dictate your choice of yeast. You should also take into consideration your own facilities. Do you have the capacity or the crash cooling ability to handle a yeast that would normally take more time to flocculate? Or do you need a yeast that will aggregate and sink like a rock so you could possibly eliminate long maturation and possibly even filtration? These questions and many more need to be addressed when selecting a yeast strain for production use. This is an enormous decision for the brewery, particularly when choosing the house strain. As this strain, its various attributes will affect most every aspect of the brewery. Starting with the brewery's brand portfolio, this is most effective when choosing the quote house strain, which is the strain that will be used for most or even all of the beers produced. This strain will have one of the largest imprints of flavor and aroma on the product, and for many breweries, is the one of the few truly proprietary ingredients. Most craft breweries opt for more neutral flavor or aroma contributions from this house strain, so as to provide the ability to produce a wider portfolio of brands and then bring in specialty strains for particular products from external suppliers. Much of the design of the brewery, including its fermentation vessel design and configuration, as well as the processing aids and procedures, are often dictated by the yeast strain. For example, breweries with a focus on lagers will opt for vessels that will enhance its flavors and aromas, and an introduction of a new ale brand into that existing fermenter design may end up requiring some revisions to the fermentation procedures, such as fermenting under pressure, variations on yeast cropping methods, and so forth. Most craft breweries in the U.S. utilize cylindroconical vessels or unitank designs to accommodate both lager and ale strains. The additional benefit of the CCV or unitank is the ability to control the temperature to curtail cropping methods for various yeast strains, for example, cooling before cropping when working with less flocculent strains. Additionally, the choice of yeast strains does impact the processes downstream, such as beer filtration and clarification, as well as VDK reduction and the maturation of the beer. Depending on the nature of the yeast strain's flocculation, special procedures may need to be employed to ensure quality crops and retained high viability, as well as VDK reduction to spec. Other accommodations for production output needs to be considered, as most lagers typically take up twice as long to produce as ales, and extra vessels may need to be installed to maintain production levels. Further, if the brewery decides to explore high gravity brewing, the yeast strain needs to be able to handle the additional stresses of fermentation, or else a new strain needs to be employed.
So as you can see, as you've heard, there's a tremendous amount of information in the narration, and that's the beauty of being able to use the scroll bar and go back exactly where you need to be to pick up the information that you might have missed. You saw appearing at the end a little button here. So this is one of those what we call them reveals. So it's just to again force you to be a little bit more interactive to keep you awake, if you will, to make sure that you get all the information. So here there's some extra information here. Okay, this one has no audio, but it clearly tells you here, when selecting your yeast strain for production use, consider the following, and then you have further information. Take note of it. Since this is a screenshot, you know that you're going to have that in the PDF file that you can download.
So now you have elected to go with a specific yeast strain. Where will you get it? There are several reputable yeast suppliers out there. They often give you a choice of either a liquid slurry.
So again, like I said earlier, you know, this is where you can stop, where you can advance the information a little bit.
production to get the new culture in-house when the brewery schedule is actually ready for it. Most times, these cultures are shipped overnight to maintain highest quality and are intended to pitch within a day or two of arrival. As a result, this increases the operating costs of the beer, and there are issues of lost packages of the yeast slurry or delays due to weather.
So let's say again, I'm just reviewing my lecture. I've taken all my notes about this particular slides, and I would like to jump. So I could go next, of course, like this. So I could go through the menu here. And I'll show you when we get to the question, but let's say I'm gonna go here.
So in looking at stepping up cultures from external suppliers specifically, we'll look at the yield factor of yeast cultures. In judging the yield factor, this greatly helps the brewer decide on the quantity of yeast cultures to purchase from an external supplier, and then be able to use smaller vessels in the brewery to step up the culture size to provide a suitable pitch rate for a production level. The yield factor looks at the cell counts of a given culture, both before and then after pitching into a small batch of fresh wort. Cell counts are performed before inoculation and then after fermentation of the small batch of wort. The equation listed shows the calculation of the yield factor as it counts the cells that were reproduced during that fermentation of that small batch of wort, and then divides by it the change in gravity in degrees Plato. Yield factor values can range widely from less than 2 to over 20. The higher values are indicative of aerobic respiration, which is generally only obtained in a laboratory setting with precise control over oxygen and nutrient levels, aimed at keeping the yeast in its respiratory phase to reproduce as many new cells as possible. In the brewery setting, especially when stepping up cultures for production pitch rates, the factor is a lot closer to about 5. Which illustrates the culture has gone through its respiratory phase and then moved on to fermentation, which is suitable when preparing cultures for production. The inoculation rate does have a high impact on the yield factor, as it does determine how long of a respiratory phase the yeast culture will go through. Too high of an inoculation rate, such as about 200 million cells per milliliter, results in a very low yield factor as the culture moves into fermentation very quickly. According to a study performed by White Labs, the ideal inoculation rate of about 70 to 100 million cells per milliliter and achieves a yield factor of generally around 7.5. This is important when choosing to step up a culture into a smaller fermenter in preparation for larger production volumes.
I'm going to stop for a second here. I have a good question from Jason. Is there an option for closed caption? Unfortunately, no, not at this point, Jason. The short answer is no. There's no closed caption. You can obviously listen and re-listen and stop and go back to get the information you're looking for. But we have not included at this point the option of closed caption. I'm going to show you again in the menu. So this is where we are. There's something I wanted to show you in the previous slide. So I'm just going to...
So now moving toward yeast propagation.
I'm just going to kill the sound for a second and just move this a little bit further like that. And there's some information here. So let's see what's in that information. I'm simply doing that because I know that some of the knowledge check that we're going to see in a second has a part of this, so pay attention here at, let's say, the temperature is dropping, and the volume factor of 10, and then less than 10, only about a factor of 3. So what happens is that throughout the gonna put that sound back up, throughout the lecture you have what we call this knowledge check. The first idea is to give you a little bit of a break from the narration and listening to a lecture and to take notes, but also to just help you to kind of evaluate, if you will, if you have captured the information that you just have seen. So in this particular lecture, there's over 37 questions that are spread throughout the entire lecture to help you, retain a little bit more of the information. So a new propagation of yeast cultures should occur approximately every 10 to 12 generations to avoid genetic drift and changes in flavor aroma profiles. I must apologize. This is a little piece of information that I skipped. I shouldn't have done that. But anyway, at the end, you are guaranteed that the question that is being asked belongs to material that I've just seen since prior. So let's say, I'm going to say false. And I submit, it's incorrect. Okay, that's fine. It tells me if it's correct or incorrect. But really where the educational value resides, it's in all the information that is given in the feedback. And this is, I think that the learner will appreciate that very, very quickly, that there's a tremendous amount of information in the feedback. So here, remember, it is highly recommended renewing your cultures, ale and lager, after no more than 10 to 12 generations, not only for the increased potential of contaminants accumulating in the harvested yeast, but also for the fact that over time, the very small incremental changes occurring within your culture could and will affect the flavor aroma profile. Continue. Goes another question. As yeast cultures are propagated toward production scales, the medium temperature increases incrementally to prepare the yeast for fermentation temperatures. Well, I don't think that it's increased. I think that it's decreased. I'm going to say false. Bravo. I have it correct. Okay, this is nice. But again, a little bit more information here. The medium temperature is gradually decreased at each step to achieve the normal operational temperature set point when the culture is finally reaching production level. For instance, lager yeast propagation will begin at 20°C to be eventually pitched into a full fermenter at 12°C. Here, there's a third one, but you know what? I say, okay, well, I don't want to go through my knowledge check now. I'm going to review them later. So I'm going to skip and I'm going to go to the next slide. And I have a couple of questions here that I'm going to address. Thank you, David. So David mentioned that SCORM, which is what it is. It's a SCORM package. Offers that option. I have to admit, I'm not the greatest when it comes down to that. I know that the lectures themselves, after they have been prepared, like I said, under guidance by our content expert, and we have find the pictures that we want and so on and so forth. All that goes to our IT e-learning group that puts that into a package called Articulate Storyline 360. And then the SCORM package is made from there. And from there, it is uploaded onto this platform, which is maybe some people realize what it is. It's a Moodle platform that allows a lot of things. So I will check this out, David. To be honest with you, there's also a lot of intellectual property protection, if you will. We give you all the screenshots, and actually you will receive or you can download the PDF in two different formats, one in full color and the other one is prepared in black and white with space for you to take notes directly there if you want to. But we have elected at this point not to make the narration easily available, if you will. So, but you know, there's always a way to improve, and we will certainly take all your recommendation in consideration. Jason again says, how much outside reading and understanding are we going to need to be able to understand and complete the web course. Okay, Jason here, let's try to make sure we're on the same page here in terms of what we're talking about. Those lectures are what we consider the advanced level. That being said, you know, anybody can take them. There's no prerequisite to them, but they are at the advanced level. So yes, indeed, you need some pre-acquired knowledge. You need some pre-acquired information to achieve that. The same way that those lectures, when they will be all completed, will replace all the lectures that are in our advanced brewing theory program. And what we have in terms of prerequisite admission for the ABT, the Advanced Brewing Theory Program, is either an admission test that you can take online or at least having taken the concise course. Again, when everything was revamped, everything was really well done in a way that you have really a progressive, ascending depth of knowledge. So the executive, the concise, and the ABT at the end of the day covers exactly the same thing, meaning everything from barley to brewing engineering. That being said, for the same, basically call it umbrella, the executive has only 17 lectures, the concise has 33 lectures, and by the time you go through the ABT, you have over 100 lectures. So as you can see, it all covers the same umbrella, but in deeper and deeper information. So people that are taking the ABT needs to prove to us that they have already acquired enough knowledge. And the idea is just to make them successful. We want them to be successful. If you're reading a book that is way over your head, well, one, you won't appreciate it. You won't retain anything. And at the end of the day, you'll be very frustrated. So when it comes down to the specialized lectures, there's no prerequisite, but we clearly announced that it is of the advanced level. Rob here, where would you get the fresh wort for the sculpture? Is it necessary to take it from an easier batch, or is there an easier way? Rob, this is a very specific question on this, and I appreciate that. Different approach. People that are brewing, that are actively brewing, you can take a sample right off the wort heat exchanger. We used to take it on the hot side of things to make sure that we're eliminating any possible contaminants, and then we were using that wort. Or when wort was not available, we were simply preparing a small malt extract that would allow us to start our cultures. David here, do alumni have access to the online version of these courses? Again, I'm just going to say those are not courses, those are lectures. A course is is several lectures, if you will. So the same way, like I said, the concise course has 33 lectures or 33 topics, whereas the ABT has three modules, and each module has over 30 different lectures each. So those are courses or program. What we are viewing today, they are simply lectures. Do the alumni have access to this that they may have completed in Chicago and in Munich? Unfortunately, no, David. David, what you have when you were taking the course, this is basically the same depth of knowledge. This is presented differently on a different platform, but it's the same information. So let me continue a little bit more, and then we're going to open for further questions. Let's see one more slide or so.
Typical pitch rates are around 1 million cells per milliliter per degree Plato for ale strains, and upwards of 1.5 million cells per milliliter per degree Plato for lager yeast strains. These rates may vary based on individual yeast strains, with strains performing better with a raised or lower rate from this standard. Some strains, such as Weizen strains, when producing Hefeweizen styles, will provide a better aromatic profile when slightly underpitched, with ranges about 0.75 million cells per milliliter per degree Plato. By monitoring the pitching rates, brewers can hone in and find the best pitch rate for each brand, and thus a greater control over the flavor and aroma profile of the product, as well as a healthy culture for future batches.
So we're here again. We have a little button here, a little reveal.
This graph illustrates different attenuation rates for various pitch rates and shows how increasing the pitch rate can dramatically reduce the time needed to reach terminal extract or gravity. Part of this is the speed through the respiratory phase. When the pitch rate is increased to threefold over the standard, the yeast culture moves quickly into fermentation and rapidly drops the extract or gravity. Underpitching can result in prolonged fermentation times as well as the potential to underattenuate. However, this graph does not illustrate the ramifications of pitching rates on the flavor profile nor the effects of the culture's prolonged health in future batches.
So from here, I hope you got a little bit of a taste of what those lectures are all about and how they are built and where they reside. So I'm going to close that and show you one last thing about the platform and the specialized lectures, and it is the badges that I mentioned. So it gives you those badges. It was just delayed a little bit. So if I go to my dashboard, the front page, it says here how the badges work. Okay, so I can make that disappear like this, but how the badges work. And I'm going to read it because I think it's very important. It's part of the entire concept of what those badges are. So badges are divided into six different categories. So you have them here. You have malting and raw materials, brew house, yeast and cellars, quality assurance and control, packaging and engineering. For somebody like David that went through the ABT, he will probably recognize that series 100 and 200 makes up module 1, series 3 and 4 is module 2, and series 5 and 6 is module 3. So that's for the ABT program. So to receive a badge for the lecture you are enrolled for, you must view all slides and submit answers to all the questions encountered throughout the lecture, referred as the knowledge check. So we saw those knowledge check. The answers do not need to be correct in order to be awarded a badge, because the educational value is in the feedback provided for each question. So you saw a couple of examples where, simple as a true or false, yes, it's telling you that you are correct or you are not, but the value is in that box of feedback, where you get a tremendous amount of extra information that, of course, is directly related to the information. So those are the badges. And as I've showed you earlier, you know, this is all the badges that I have accumulated over time. So brew house and yeast and cellars, and this one is quality control and packaging and engineering here. So the idea, and I must admit, we have not vetted totally the concept, but the idea would be that, you know, if you accumulate enough badges within a series or within a module, we could basically ask you or offer you to take a test like the learners that took, let's say, the Advanced Brewing Theory program, take the same test, which would allow you to get your certificate of completion. So I think I've gone through about everything I wanted you to see. If you have any question, please do not hesitate, or simply you can reach me here. Oops, sorry, I missed that. rdubé@siebelinstitute.com. I highly invite you to go take a look at the entire list of lectures. Like I said, we have about 70 plus right now, And by the end of the year and early next year, we should be close to 100. Go take a look, siebelinstitute.com, the website. And then on the front page, there's a tab that says Program Courses. It's a drop-down menu where you're going to see all courses, entry level, intermediate level, advanced level, and then underneath specialized lectures. And actually, I should do this and show you if it works. Okay, so this is our website, and right here, Program Courses, Specialized Lectures. And you can search the lectures by series. So if you're interested in something that pertains to brew house or yeast and cellars, so I'm going to do that, and it's going to give you all the lectures that pertains to this particular series. You can enroll or purchase directly from this platform, and you will receive your credentials within minutes. I have not mentioned that, but those lectures, the cost of those lectures are based on the length of narration. So kind of a three price point, if you will. One, when the narration is under 50 minutes, when the narration is between 50 and 60 minutes, and when it's above 60 minutes. Sorry. And the lectures are available from the time of purchase. The lectures are available for 10 days. PDF is yours. Access to the platform is yours. Whatever you have put on your files, that's yours. But the lecture itself with the narration is available for 10 days, as well as the access to a monitor that will answer all your questions. So at this point, people, I certainly enjoy my hour. I'll stick around a little bit longer if there's any questions. Again, I think that it is to the point, those specialized lectures, because again, not everybody has the time nor the finance to get into a full-blown courses. However, in our book, we believe that everybody in the industry should be at least concise, savvy. We believe that an educated brewer becomes a best brewer and therefore produce best beer. Remember that the consumer is also getting a little bit more educated, and they will be able to make the difference between your IPA and somebody else's IPA. And if they prefer the other one, well, you're a little bit out of luck. And so therefore, we have to learn to take into consideration that, you know, the leap between a home brewer to a craft brewer that stays in the tap room, I call that tap room fresh. Between you and I, a lot of people, if not everybody, can achieve that. But if they're becoming successful and now they want to go into distribution, this is where you need to learn the details of beer production. Me, I came from the quote unquote from the big guys, so I've learned first the theory and the science between all this before moving to the craft industry, where I kind of learned a little bit more the creative side of the business. But at the end of the day, I can assure you that both angles are tremendously important, especially if you want to grow and begin distributing. So again, my name is Richard Dubé. I'm the director of online education. You can reach me again at this address up here, at rdubé@siebelinstitute.com, and it'll be my pleasure to answer any of your questions. Again, I hope that I whet your appetite a little bit to get a little bit more brewing education, and stay safe and healthy, and things will obviously get better as we go. So I'm going to leave you with a little bit more of my techno music. take care of yourself, stay healthy and safe.